Good morning to everyone, and welcome to Hope Church. We're very glad that we can join together on a beautiful sunny morning like this, even though it is still a bit chilly out. The sun makes us think that maybe winter's almost over. Maybe not. No real announcements today. But rest assured that there will be some elders over here on the south, north, and we will be there to pray with anyone who has something to share, whether it be a celebration or a need. So again, welcome, and Vera is going to call us into worship.
Jesus Christ is the light of the world. We light this candle as a sign that Christ has come and Christ will come again. As the light pushes back the darkness, let us walk with, learn from, and worship Jesus Christ.
Please, if you can, rise for the call to worship. As followers of Jesus Christ living in this world, which some seek to control and others view with despair, we declare with joy and trust. From the beginning, through all the crises of our times, until the kingdom fully comes, God keeps covenant forever. God is king. Let the earth be glad. Christ is victor. His rule has begun. The Spirit is at work. Creation is renewed.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord.
Thank you.
To God's people gathered in hope, grace to you, mercy, and peace from God our Creator and Christ our Redeemer, through the presence and power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. As God has greeted you, so too, take a moment, mill about, greet one another.
Children will come forward for Children in Worship and God Loves Me. Come, yay. In Children in Worship this morning, we're going to hear the story of Jesus in the wilderness. All right, you guys know what we're going to say? Ready? Now, one, two, three. The peace of Christ be with you. All right, let's go this way.
The service of reconciliation. Together, male and female, single and married, young and old, every hue and variety of humanity, we are called to represent God, for the Lord God made us all. All spheres of life, family and friendship, work and worship, school and state, play and art, bear the wounds of our rebellion.
Thank you.
Remembering the promise to reconcile the world to himself, God joined our humanity in Jesus Christ, the eternal Word made flesh.
He is the long-awaited Messiah, one with us and one with God, fully human and fully divine, conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary.
Standing in our place, Jesus suffered during his years on earth, especially in the tortures of the cross. He carried God's judgment on our sin. His sacrifice removed our guilt.
God raised him from the dead. He walked out of the grave, conqueror of sin and death, Lord of life.
We are set right with God, given new life, and called to walk with him in freedom from sin's dominion.
Thank you.
The Spirit gathers people from every tongue, tribe, and nation into the unity of the body of Christ.
Anointed and sent by the Spirit, the church is thrust into the world, ambassadors of God's peace, announcing forgiveness and reconciliation, proclaiming the good news of grace.
Going before them and with them, the Spirit convinces the world of sin and pleads the cause of Christ.
Men and women, impelled by the Spirit, go next door and far away into science and art, media and marketplace, every area of life, pointing to the reign of God with what they do and say.
Please turn with me to the book of Genesis, the 9th chapter. Genesis chapter 9, and we're going to begin reading at the 18th verse. Turns out I never wrote a sermon or looked at this text in the past very closely. You'll see why in a minute. Genesis chapter 9, beginning at verse 18. Listen then for the voice of God. The sons of Noah, who came out of the ark, were Shem, Ham, and Japheth. Ham was the father of Canaan. These were the three sons of Noah, and from them came the people who were scattered over the whole earth. Noah, a man of the soil, proceeded to plant a vineyard. When he drank some of its wine, he became drunk and lay uncovered inside his tent. Ham, the father of Canaan, saw his father's nakedness and told his two brothers outside. But Shem and Japheth took a garment and laid it across his shoulders, and then they walked in backwards and covered their father's nakedness. Their faces were turned the other way so that they could not see their father's nakedness. When Noah awoke from his wine and found out what his youngest son had done to him, he said, "Cursed be Canaan, the lowest of slaves will be to his brothers. Will he be to his brothers?" And he also said, "Praise be to the Lord, the God of Shem. May Canaan be the slave of Shem. May God extend Japheth's territory. May Japheth live in the tents of Shem, and may Canaan be the slave of Japheth." And after the flood, Noah lived 350 years. Noah lived a total of 950 years. And then he died. The word of the Lord. To walk with our two grandchildren, Sandy and I have two grandchildren, to walk with them is to learn that Jack thinks puddles are to be avoided. Emma thinks puddles are to be splashed in. Jack will skirt the potential mess. Emma will jump in and stomp around and make the mess bigger. This morning's sermon is a puddle that I'd like to step around. Classis Chicago South, the regional governing body of the Christian Reformed Church, asked that churches preach on race and unity. And they recommended a three-part sermon series based on a 1996 denominational study on race. We did race in the 90s and sexuality in the 2020s. In response, one local church is doing 6 weeks of sermons. Others are ignoring the request. We're going to do a two-part sermon this week and next. But this is a puddle that I'd like to avoid. And the process for writing topical sermons feels completely backwards to me. Therefore, this is a meandering, muddled, muddy mess. Just going to jump in and splash around a bit. So where would you start? Where would you begin to think, talk, preach, or splash around about race? We each have our own stories and family histories for understanding race. We each come at this with different understandings of terms and different readings of political, social, and economic implications of race. We all have our own implicit biases. We all have our own prejudices. And everyone does what's right in their own eyes. I've heard us, Hope folks, I've heard us get all lathered up about the prophets and the profiteers of race, about Black Lives Matter, critical race theory, the woke mob, mass incarceration, and living through neighborhood changes. I've heard us mimic inflections whenever we repeat what someone says who's black or Hispanic or Indian. And no one is eager to stand up and confess that they're a racist, even though, depending on the definition, we could all rightly join in that confession. And of course, it got really quiet in here. Of course, all of this is complicated by living in Chicagoland. Because of white flight and links to race, crime, and housing values, many of us feel like we live on the front lines or the fault lines of race in America. When my doctor is Pakistani, my grocer is Palestinian, my favorite restaurant is Mexican, my friend is black, and my neighbors are mixed, we live in the diaspora of every race and culture under the sun, thanks be to God. So where would you start? Where would you start? I'm going to start with Genesis. A reformed biblical understanding of everything always begins with the goodness of the created order. And from the very beginning, the activity of God explodes with a myriad of divisions. Darkness and light, the waters above from the waters below, land from water, animals from human beings, male and female, etc., etc. Variety and diversity are built into the very nature of creation. And as the CRC study to, this is the title, articulate biblical and theological principles for the development of a racially and ethnically diverse family of God, put it, this is from the study, the crown of this varied creation is the human person, God's image bearers. As God's image bearers, all human beings, without exception, are endowed with royal dignity and share in dominion over all creation. And God blesses them with fruitfulness. All their descendants, without exception, also share equally in this royal dignity. Human beings also image God in their capacity for loving relationships with God and with each other in righteousness and holiness. That's where we start. Bearing the image of God. But you know the rest of the story. It quickly goes sour. The shalom that God intended is spoiled. A mutually supportive webbing is soon frayed. Relationships are fragmented. And brother is alienated from brother. Only 4 chapters into Genesis, and there's a murder. Only 6 chapters in, and I quote from Genesis, the Lord saw how great the wickedness of the human race had become on earth, and every inclination of the human heart was only evil all the time. So the Lord regretted that he had made human beings on the earth, and his heart was deeply troubled. Therefore, God selects and spares Noah, but endeavors to, and again, a quote, wipe from the earth the human race. Which is where our text picks up. Noah's boat has run aground. And as humanity's do-over, Noah disembarks with a covenant from God and the instruction to be fruitful and multiply. But no sooner had Noah planted a vineyard when after an evening of drinking, he's passed out naked. Ham, one of Noah's sons, discovers his disrobed dad and invites his brothers to come and take a peek. They refuse and throw a blanket over their father. There's all manner of speculation, by the way. There is all manner of speculation about what this episode meant or included. But when Noah comes to, he curses Ham and his descendants to perpetual servitude. Now, it's helpful to remember that early in Genesis, after killing his brother, Cain is marked by God so that those seeing the marking wouldn't kill him. And this is where interpreting the curse of Ham takes a damning twist. The Hebrew meaning of Ham's name was dark or black. Hence, dark-skinned people were thought to be marked by God for servitude or subjugation or slavery. Our text gets translated as a biblical basis for race-based slavery, although there is no biblical evidence that Ham was the father of Africa. There is evidence that various Jewish, Christian, and Islamic leaders and theologians used this text to justify centuries of African enslavement. Now, the very next chat, you're still with me, turns out. The very next chapter in Genesis includes a table of nations, suggesting a way to understand the lineage of ethnicities and people groups. And in the chapter after that, the tale of the Tower of Babel becomes a way to explain the confusion of language and the scattering of humanity. So, dear friends, while diversity was built into the original intention of creation, that same diversity ends up being a matter of division and oppression. And our text gets used to prop up slavery and race-based inequality for centuries. For example, in the run-up to the American Civil War, the president of the Southern Baptist Convention writes, "From Ham were descended the nations that occupied the land of Canaan and those that now constitute the African or Negro race. The inheritance, according to prophecy, has been and will continue to be slavery. As long as we have the Bible, we expect to maintain it." So rather than embracing the gift of ethnic and cultural richness, humanity is fractured by ideas about race. Another example? In 1857, in West Michigan, the Christian Reformed Church was formed by new Dutch immigrants who couldn't cotton to their Americanized relatives. Therefore, for almost 100 years, the CRC remained an almost exclusively Dutch-American denomination. CRC World Missions were sent out to people of other races and cultures in other lands, while the task of home missionaries was primarily to gather the sheep of Dutch descent who were scattered beyond the reach of already established congregations in Canada and the United States. By the way, not my interpretation. This is directly from that report. The earliest exception was a sustained outreach to the Navajo and Zuni people in New Mexico and Arizona. And a variety of efforts at outreach in Northern American cities, Chicago, Harlem, Grand Rapids. But these mission outposts were often pastored by lay pastors, and the gatherings were thought of as chapels. So it wasn't until 1958 that the CRC recognized an all-Navajo congregation as a full-fledged, fully organized church. It seems that racial or ethnic hierarchy was built into church order. Too much? Not fair? How about this? In 1908, the CRC appointed a synodical committee to study the status of adopted children, whether or not adopted children could be baptized. A couple of years of study later, Synod declared that children were, and I quote, not in the covenant because blood relationship mattered, unquote. The covenant, the same one traced all the way back to Noah, was somehow transmitted by blood. And it took until the 1960s and 70s before this fully got resolved by the CRC. You get the idea. My wife is worried that this will sound like finger wagging. Again, this is a puddle that I'd rather avoid. Dear friends, the misinterpretation of Genesis 9 is but one example of how race is used in a way to explain, dehumanize, and oppress others. It's one more example of how race is a social construct. And this is what I came to say. Race is a social construct. Scripture teaches that there is one human race. There's a diversity of ethnicities. We're all ethnic. You could all open up your own restaurant. We're all ethnic. But there's only one human race. There's genetic diversity and cultural diversity. There's physical, geographic, and evolutionary differences in humanity. But variety and diversity are endemic to bearing the image of God. All of humanity bears the image of God without hierarchy, without limitation, without distinction. We're not closer to what God intended. We construct ideas about race as flawed, fallen, and frightened people. We create ideas about race. The CRC study puts it this way. The loss of proper self-understanding creates fear and anxiety. In this crisis of self-understanding, we often turn to racial, ethnic, or cultural forms of self-confirmation and self-understanding. At the very least, these forms of self-confirmation are incomplete and distorted. These forms of self-confirmation become idolatrous. We recreate God in our own image. These forms of self-confirmation also often become the means by which we harm others who are different from ourselves. As differences between individuals or groups increase, so does fear. And the cycles of fear and differentiation spirals in intensity. The effect on the community is pain, misery, and brokenness. Which is why the claim, I don't see color, seems noble of intention, but does a disservice to the one we claim to see. We are all complex and complicated products of history. None of us stand alone, but we are propped up and shaped by cultures and systems. We have benefited from and been limited by institutions, educational opportunities, housing practices, economic realities, and theological worldviews. No one is free from the shaping power of historical realities and cultural patterns. Racism is not just a function of an individual. It's the result and participates in systems. And those same forces, those same systems are bent and broken by sin. We live in a muddy, muddled mess. So, dear sons and daughter of Noah, as those who inhabit the same covenant and will of God as did Shem, Ham, and Japheth, by commission and omission, we've failed to love our neighbors as ourselves. In particular, we fail to love our neighbors of different ethnic experience. Therefore, it behooves us to start with confession. But let us also take heart in the hope and healing balm as described in the CRC report. These lines. Only love, the perfect love of God, can give people a renewed identity that casts out fear and anxiety and gives them the courage to relinquish these incomplete and harmful ways of identifying themselves. Only love, the perfect love of God, can create a new heart, can create new hearts that cause people to see the world and others in new ways. To that redemptive love of God, we now turn. Next week. Amen.
Thank you. Would you pray with me? Our Lord, our Redeemer, Creator, lover of all of us, we come to you this morning and we ask for your guidance and grace in our communal lives. We are thinking about folks that we know close. Ron Lavery, first of all, in the hospital, recovering from his surgery. We also are thinking of Dick Lubbers, who is at Palos Hospital, being examined and hopefully restored. We know that there's many things that are happening with folks that are close to us that we don't know about, and we ask that you'll be with them in their time of need. We're grateful, too, for good gifts. Gifts like grandchildren, like Chloe that was bestowed on Chris and Dave Jalsma. We think about folks who are missing folks. That probably includes almost all of us in one way or another. We ask that you'll give grace to all of those folks who are missing folks, and to those souls who are seeking redemption, which pretty much includes all of us. We ask that you will call our hearts to love everybody, no matter who they are or where their generations stem from. Open our eyes, open our hearts, to do your love and to do your work in this world. We ask this in Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you. with me. Creator, Father God, thank you for the beauty of the world. Thank you for the ways that you've blessed us. Please accept these offerings back to you in the work here at Hope and through the Deacon Special Fund, including the support to PADS and the work they do for people experiencing homelessness. Please help us to offer our hearts and our hands and our lives throughout this week in blessing to you. In your name we pray. Amen.
A couple quick announcements. One is that catechism, this morning's catechism class, we are going to gather in here to hear Ted Boswell talk about what it means to be reformed. I know that's disappointing that you're not going to gather with donuts in the back room with me, but this is top drawer. Catechism in here, what does it mean to be reformed? I will regret telling you this, but I've had a number of people talk to me about it in the last couple days. We baptized a baby last week, two kids last week. One of those kids was heavy. And it looked for a second there like I was going to drop that kid, like I wasn't strong enough. I've been on some medicine that was suppressing my blood pressure. I don't have high, whatever, but it wasn't that I was going to drop the kid. I was going to go down. Remember I said I couldn't read? That's because it was doing this. It was just getting dark. I mean, it was not my finest moment, but made for memorable baptism for that kid. So I am okay. Those of you that come up and ask me, I was really worried about you. You were so gray. Turns out. So please join me in this parting benediction. We rejoice in the goodness of God. Renounce the works of darkness and dedicate ourselves to holy living.
Partners, set free for joyful obedience, we offer our lives and lives to do God's work in the world.
With tempered impatience, eager to see injustice ended, we expect the day of the Lord. We are confident that the light which shines in the present darkness will fill the earth when Christ appears.
Come, Lord Jesus, our world belongs to you.
Amen.